Hello, everyone. My name is Qing Lan. I'm one of the engineers at Amazon Web Services. Today, I'm going to start with the first courses of our series, a brief introduction about DeepJavaLibrary. So firstly, let's go through what is actually DeepJavaLibrary is. DeepJavaLibrary is a deep learning framework that is written in Java, to be simple. It supports both training and inference, like the majority deep learning framework would do. And it works the way it's engine agnostic, means like it's not only just a deep learning framework, it's on its behind, it's integrating with the other deep learning framework, such as TensorFlow, PyTorch, MXNet, Onyx Runtime, and even Paddle. And DeepJavaLibrary works seamlessly with the C++ API on the backend with this deep learning framework that's serving as a single frontend instead of the Java. And DeepJavaLibrary is also supporting for different high performance operators. It's such as some mathematical operators like sum or subtraction, multiple or division. And it's even supporting some of the advanced operator like softmax and all the neural networks operation. And behind it, it's leveraging all the resource that your system have, such as CPU, GPU, and even can be running fine on the edge devices such as Android. DeepJavaLibrary consists of several key components. First of thing is the API. It's the core about DeepJavaLibrary itself, why the user would only can write a very simple code and achieve a very high level deep learning use cases. It's been designed to be Java friendly and very easy to use. So the user can down an inference code pretty much in 10 lines. And majority of the training code, including the building of the neural networks inside of like 30 lines of code. Apart from that, DeepJavaLibrary is also having a very concrete model zoo design. It's been designed into enterprise level. It has multiple ways for user to do the encryptions and also the management on different model with their different versions. And the user can actually building a centralized model hub serving in anywhere with the DeepJavaLibrary model zoo components. And to load the model is also very simple through the model zoo. It's only just in one line. DeepJavaLibrary also supporting for the data set. It has the majority data sets such as the ImageNet, and also the COCO dataset for the CV part. We also have the Stanford review and also several majority NLP cases like the frequently used dataset. And also there's another one called Wikipedia, the Wikipedia dataset. And behind all of these majority components, DeepJavaLibrary consists of the engine which is the core part for it, such as the TensorFlow engine. It's leveraging the TensorFlow C++ API directly on the TensorFlow engine that implements all the APIs, model zoo, and dataset components. And similarly, there are also PyTorch and MXN engines, and also all the different engines that DeepJavaLibrary currently support. So based on that, the user experiences, they wouldn't care much about which engine they're leveraging on. And essentially all they need to do is just calling the method inside the API package, and they should be able to run their training and inference task seamlessly, even if they're trying to switch the different engines. And they will have the exact same behaviors. And the key part for DeepJavaLibrary in our design is we focus on the cool feature that Java provides is you only write once and you can run it anywhere. That applies to DeepJavaLibrary as well. So maybe now into that part, after I introducing about the key components, you may wondering why we actually use Java for deep learning, and also like why we build DeepJavaLibrary for deep learning. There are not only just one people asking me like why you just simply use a Python package and then or maybe some other language binding to build this whole solutions, why we even invented for the Java. The first thing, we actually summarized the result that came from this slide. The first group of the users that came into our mind is the people who is actually using Java for production services. That's mostly applies in under the enterprise customer, that's including Amazon. They are trying to build a very low latency and high throughput inference services. Because of their latency and throughput requirement, DeepJavaLibrary is very crucial for them to solve this problem. It can support into nanosecond level of performance boost, and also they can ensure that the service can have a really high level scalability. Which means like if you, and because of the Java itself is really mature in the serving industry. So the user can integrate DeepJavaLibrary with the advanced serving solutions together to make sure that their service can run at the best performance. Another problem for people is because they want something very stable. Because especially for some mission critical services, that has very low tolerance on the failures. They really need something very stable. So people typically run with DeepJavaLibrary. They want us to have like more than 100 hours of running stabilities. And this 100 hours means the continuous inferencing. And for the third reasons, it's because of for the people who choose Java other than Python to build their solution is because they would like to have memory saving. Comparing to the Python solutions, Java can leverage the multi-threading solution directly, which means they can enable all the cores for the inference without having much of the memory wasting on the duplication of the model loading. And additionally, if they would like to leverage GPU with their Java services, DeepJavaLibrary is also the portal for their solution. The second majority of the people, they would like to use DeepJavaLibrary to build their deep learning model is they want the readability and reliability in their code space. Especially for different services that's serving in different industry, they would like to have their API design very clear. And they also need to have all parts of the error handling. They really don't want anything that happened in the middle that some random error message thrown out and they have no clues about how they can solve the problem. DeepJavaLibrary built a very concrete logging systems, which means you can pretty much figure out the root cause of the problem easily throughout the code building and also the runtime. And also the third group for the people is very simple. They are the people who actually just like the Java or they are basically the Java developers. They like to build everything inside of Java. And Java can be a really nice tool for the deep learning itself. So for this group of people, DeepJavaLibrary provides, we actually provide a deep learning book for the Java called D2L Java. Now it's available from our website. It's actually the first book in the industry that teach people how you can do deep learning in purely Java from a scratch of the model until the full inference and the training different tasks. It's including all the CV and NLP models that are popular in the industry. Apart from that, for people who are very, like if you're at your beginner level, you can go to our DeepJavaLibrary Zero, which is a package we basically call it like a playground for everyone to try out deep learning directly inside of Java. And for that one, it's even simpler. You can even build out of your training blocks and then start the training in less than 10 lines of the code. It's designed for everyone who like to do training on their own or solve some simple tasks. And it also bridges our advanced API easily. So at any time you would like to, you know, configure something really in the advanced level, you can switch from the zero package to our main package to do all your training and inference tasks. So now let's look at the inference. What can DeepJavaLibrary provide? There is a very interesting use cases on the right-hand side. It's actually, I created a simple Android applications that can recognize the doodle that people draw. And the one I'm trying to draw there is a rabbit, and it's recognized seamlessly directly from the Android device, bring you the output. And DeepJavaLibrary on the inference part, it can provide up to 2x or even more performance boost on the multi-threading inference, especially on some small models, if you're trying to compare that with the Python model server. And the DeepJavaLibrary on the inference task is very stable. Especially inside of Amazon, there's a certain service we call tier one services. That means like the services we really wouldn't want these things crash. If it crash, we're going to lose millions of the revenue onto the products. So these services are many of them are currently running DeepJavaLibrary with the inference. And something we have to make sure is, as we have mentioned before, is the 100 hours and even more continuous inference call. We have to make sure these things are going to be very stable without causing any problem. And the third part is memory saving. So in theory, people can spawn a limit threads instead of a Java. And then these newer spawn threads won't have any impacts on the memory cost. If you see the graph below, comparing to the Python solution, because Python cannot really run the true multi-threading, most of the people would do is they're creating multiple process. But for each process, they have to load on the model. And for each time of the model loading, they're going to consume some of the memory instead of system. So there is going to be a memory bomb. So saying that for a quick example, on a small machine, if you're trying to spawn 5 process inside of Python, it may hit the memory bomb. But if you're trying to compare into Java, because DeepJavaLibrary support multi-threading inference from its natural way, so you can spawn like 5 different thread and run multi-threading inference with alongside with Python. And even there's a slight performance boost. For some of the services that are currently running, as we have, as far as we know, they're leveraging more than 100 cores on a single machine to do the large scale online inference task. And if you're trying to spawn 100 inference process, it's going to be impossible and going to consume much of the memory. But if it's 100 different thread inside of Java, it's going to be very it's going to be very natural, because Java essentially just built to do this kind of work. So now let's move on into the training part. So training on the DeepJavaLibrary isn't that mature comparing to the Python task comparing to the inference task, to be honest. But it is now already have the majority parts you can leverage on, such as the popular neural networks on the CNN, RNN, LSTM, and even the transformers. And people even build BERT with DeepJavaLibrary. There are building metrics and autograph functionality, which you can compute the dynamic graph directly. That's the most popular way that people currently leveraging on for TensorFlow, PyTorch, and MXNet. DeepJavaLibrary also support for reinforcement learning, and we create a very simple example on the right-hand side. As you can see, there's a Flappy Bird that people train with 3 million different steps, and now the birds can go beyond 20,000 scores, or basically that means 20,000 of tubes without dying. And this can be done purely inside of Java. And DeepJavaLibrary also supporting for online machine learning, saying that you can combine that with the popular streaming services such as Apache Flink or AWS Kinesis, which allow you to fine tuning on your model directly online without even have to switch into the other languages or framework. Once the model fine tuning is finished, you can use your same Java service and redeploy the model to run for the inference. And finally, you can take a look at our book. We already provide the URL here. It's called d2l.dgl.ai. It's provide a very comprehensive way for you to get started with deep learning. It's a Java version of this, our original book that's been built inside of Amazon. And it provides the Jupyter notebook way for you to run the notebook interactively. So that can be really helpful for your learning process. And now let's look at our DeepJavaLibrary customers. Originally, DeepJavaLibrary were born from Amazon based on the internal need from our different customers. They would like to have us to build something that for that can work perfectly for Java. And then we made this open source. For now on, for DeepJavaLibrary is open source back in 2019 in December. Until on the February of 2021, we have many customers and it's been using in Amazon widely. Such as Amazon retail, they use this information to analyze on the logs, and also like Amazon Music and Amazon Ads. For Ads, there are many different use cases to deal with the typical recommendation services, and also there are the different Ads tasks that people leveraging on, and also Amazon Web Services and Alexa. Most of the customers inside of Amazon that actually choose DeepJavaLibrary is because it can provide ultra fast level of inference, because people, when they trying to build up different services, they would like to have something really can run really fast with very low latency and a very high throughput. And there are also groups of people inside of Amazon, they're looking for a solution that can help them to deal with the enormous of their data information. That leads to the DeepJavaLibrary can work really well with the big data platform such as Apache Spark. You can leverage that on AWS EMR. And now we have customers running their daily services that are dealing with more than 800 millions of the data information in just of the eight hours. If you're trying to compare that with their previous Python solutions, it's almost cut the total time into half. They usually have to run the whole services that's inside of 24 hours to deal with all the offline inference. And now it's only down inside of 8 hours. And here's another customers that actually leveraging DeepJavaLibrary really, really well is Netflix. They're building the online streaming services that based on the deep learning task. And especially when they're dealing with the logging, they build the automated services that can automatically identify the anomaly from their services based on the logs they collected from the system. And this requires very high throughput and also kind of low latency, because they really would like to have this information to be collected in real time, so they can automatically try to fix out the problem. So that's it about the brief view about DeepJavaLibrary. Now you can get started with our DeepJavaLibrary learning journey. In the next few videos, we're going to introduce about the key components that I have covered from my first few slides. That's including the array, the training task, inference task, and also the other very interesting things you should know about DeepJavaLibrary. And finally, don't forget to join our DeepJavaLibrary community, where you can ask our questions, or if you have any concerns or questions about how to do things inside of Java, you can reach out to us here. We are really happy to help you. We are available on the GitHub discussion. We do have a Slack room, and we even, if you're speaking Chinese or you're living in China, we have our WeChat channel that's available for everyone to ask any questions, or if you're seeking for help from us. So thank you.